2 Peter. I just want to say a happy Easter to everybody again, and this is Easter Sunday. What a privilege it is just to be able to be in church this morning. For those of you that frequent church often, thank you for being here again. And for those of you that only come at Christmas and Easter, we do this every week this time. It's pretty good even, actually. We'd love to have you back next time. Amen. I got to throw that out there for you Greasters. You know what Greasters are, right? They're Christmas and Easter Christians. That's what Greasters are. Anyway, just a reminder to you guys, next Sunday begins our revival. And I hope that you've been praying about that. I hope you are excited about it. I hope you're going to invite some folks. Our evangelist is Barry Webb, and he's a full-time evangelist, and he'll be here with us Sunday through Thursday. And by the way, just want to remind you, there's sign-up sheets out in the hall for you to sign up for meals. We give away free food around here to get you to come, all right? Just sign up so that they know how much food to fix. 2 Peter chapter number 1, verse 1 through 4. As Peter comes in this epistle, this is just the introductory statement, just the beginning statement, but there's something in it that I want you to see this morning. On this Easter Sunday, folks, we celebrate the resurrection of Christ. As a matter of fact, we who are believers do that every Sunday. As a matter of fact, we do that every day. Because the only way we have salvation is because Jesus Christ got up out of the grave. We have a very precious salvation. And I don't know whether you guys really ever put that much thought into it. The word precious, by the way, in the Greek, as I'm about to read to you, is the word that means of a great cost. It's very costly. And folks, our faith, the Christian walk, the Christian faith, it's costly. It don't cost us a lot. It costs us nothing to get. It costs Jesus everything. But don't think that we have cheap faith. Don't think that we have a cheap salvation. Jesus suffered and died on that cross. We're going to talk about that today. He went into the grave, and on the third day he arose again. And folks, it's not a cheap thing. He suffered. And he became our sin, so that we might become the righteousness of God in Him. It's not a cheap thing. I think so many times we, as Christian people in this generation, I think we forget the amazing cost that it was of our forefathers and just allowing us to have the freedom to sit in this building this morning and praise God. Amen. Folks, don't ever forget that we're saved and we're kept saved by the precious blood of Jesus. He sacrificed it all. But don't forget that our freedoms in this nation were given to us by men and women who were willing to pay the sacrifice as well. We must remember that our freedom in this nation is not cheap. It costs blood. And our freedom in salvation is not cheap. It costs God's blood, which is worth more than all of the human blood that ever has been or ever will be. Verse 1 through verse number 4 of 2 Peter chapter 1. Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith. Again, that word precious means of a great cost. With us through the righteousness of God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. According as His divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of Him that hath called us to glory and virtue. Now I want you to notice what God called us to. God didn't call us just to meet together on Sunday morning. Hey, God didn't call us to be a part of a club. God called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises of great value, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you and we thank you and praise you, Lord, for allowing us the opportunity to gather together as a family today. Oh, Lord, I thank you for the choir and the music that they sang. That was wonderful, Lord, and I praise you and I thank you for it. And I pray, God, that they had heard, the people gathered here has heard the message and song. And Lord, their hearts are prepared now to receive that which you have for them through the preached word. And I pray, God, that you would just be with us, open our hearts and open our minds to be receptive unto you, to your will, your word, and your way. I pray, God, if there's one soul in this room that's lost, if there's one here, Lord, that's going to hell, I pray, dear God, that today you would show them your death, your burial, your resurrection. I pray you'd show them your goodness, your mercy, and your grace. I pray, God, you would save that sinner that's on their way to hell today. Oh, God, I just ask you, Father, that everything that's said and everything that's done and all that we do on this great day that you have allowed us to just celebrate your resurrection, I pray, God, it would be for your honor and your glory. And it's in the precious name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Simon Peter was a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ. Now, folks, you and I can be a servant of the Lord, but we're not apostles. I hope you know that. But I want you to know, as servants of the Lord, we've got to come as servants with the right heart and the right motive. Today we're gathered together on this Easter Sunday to celebrate the fact that our God's not dead. He's alive. We don't have Jesus hanging on a cross in our church. You know why? Because he's not still on a cross. We don't celebrate just his death, friend. We celebrate the fact that he's alive. And yes, he did die on that cross. As a matter of fact, on that cross of Calvary, he became sin for us. Thank God for that. And he did die a physical, literal death. He gave up the ghost and he died and he went into the grave. But I want you to know, on the third day, as a matter of fact, the Bible tells us that the women were walking to the tomb even while it was yet dark, and they were walking to the tomb. It was about to crest daylight, and as they got to the tomb, lo and behold, the stone's been rolled away and that tomb is empty. That stone wasn't rolled away so Jesus could get out, friend. It was rolled away so you can look in and see that we serve a risen Savior. He died like it was prophesied. He was buried like it was prophesied. And he rose again just like it was prophesied. He did what he said he was going to do. He came to do what he said he was going to do. And one day soon he's coming again. And we need to live a life of service. Our service for the Lord ought to be a service whereby we are serving one another, where we love one another, where we are doing for one another, where we go into the world and we spread that gospel message. By the way, the gospel still means good news. It is good news to a lost and dying world. Folks, get this, if you don't get anything else today. Every man, woman, and child outside of the Lord Jesus Christ is going to die and spend an eternity in hell and cast into a lake of fire where there is punishment and torture and torment. It's where the worm dies not and the fire is not quenched. It is a place of outer darkness and torment. And folks, that's where every human being is going outside of the Lord Jesus. But God gave us good news. Man does not have to go to hell because God himself came to this earth, enrobed himself in flesh, died upon that cross, went into the grave, and on the third day he got up again, having victory over hell, death, and the grave. That's the good news. And if we would repent, turn from trying to get to heaven our own way, turn from trying to be good enough, turn from our filthy, wicked, wretched lives, and turn to the Jesus Christ of the Bible, then we can be saved. And what are we saved from? We're saved from an eternal damnation and eternal hell. Are you with me this morning, church? So Simon Peter was a servant. And the way Simon Peter was a servant is the same way you and I can be a servant. And that is to go into the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And tell them about Jesus. Tell them about the Savior. And baptizing them, making disciples out of them. He went on to say this in that very first verse. That Simon Peter, he was a servant, and yes, he was an apostle. And he wrote this to all of those who had the same faith that he did. Notice what he says. And to them who have obtained like precious faith. Folks, there's only one faith that's going to get you to heaven. I want you to realize this today. And please, please understand this. This is Bible. This is God. This isn't just Pastor Paul. I want you to realize that there is no such thing as a faith outside of Jesus that gets you to heaven. You cannot put your faith in religion. You cannot put your faith in church. You cannot put your faith in baptismal waters. You cannot put your faith in giving money, in showing up for church twice a year, and showing up for church every time the doors are open. You don't put your faith in that to get you to heaven. That, my friend, is an empty and a vain faith. And you will die and go to hell if that's what you have your faith in. You don't put your faith in the fact that you prayed a prayer sometime when you were 8 or 10 or 12 years old. You don't put your faith in your grandma or your mama or your daddy or any preacher telling you that you're saved. You put your trust and your faith in none other than Jesus Christ of the Bible. You don't get saved, dear friend, by any work. You get saved by repenting and believing. And that is a matter of your will. It's a matter of the heart. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness. And then with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. We do not get saved by any work of our own. We get saved by believing in the finished work of Jesus Christ. By the way, you can do nothing to save yourself. And you can do nothing to keep yourself saved. We have the same precious, costly faith that the Apostle Peter had. Now I want you to know something. Peter had a problem with sticking his foot in his mouth all the time. Peter was an old, rugged fisherman. My friends, I want you to understand something. One of the worst memories I have of Easter was when I first got saved, or right before I got saved. I can't remember exactly now. But on Easter Sunday, my wife went out and got me a suit, a tie, and a shirt, and all that. And I would not put that thing on and go get a picture taken with her and those kids. I remember that. All that woman wanted was an Easter picture. Y'all ever have bad memories of holidays like that? Listen, I want to tell you something. All she wanted was for me to put on a suit and take a picture. And I said, you ain't catching me dead in no suit. You will never find me in a suit. I ain't never wearing a suit. Don't even tell me about a suit. Take that suit and shove it. I ain't taking a picture in no suit because I'm never going to have one. Well, the poor woman cried, drugged the kids off. They got their picture taken. I sat at home and sulked like a little school kid. By the way, how many of you men act like a baby sometimes? How many women, how many of your husbands act like a baby sometimes? Yeah, they're a little more honest. That's right. But let me tell you something. Why did I bring that up? I'm going to tell you. Folks, when I was young, I didn't understand the meaning of the cost of Easter. I mean, even when I got older, and even right after I got saved, I didn't really fully understand the cost of Easter. It's a like precious faith. It's like costly faith. Folks, it cost Jesus Christ everything to save Peter. It cost Jesus Christ everything to save you, and it cost him everything to save me. And I did not understand. I didn't understand as a young man what it meant to surrender and be a servant of Jesus. I didn't understand what it meant to just enjoy the great grace that God has given. I didn't understand what it meant to other people to celebrate this thing called Easter. And I remember being a jerk that day, but I remember this, the next Easter we were in church and I had one of these things on. Now listen, I ain't preaching to men ought to wear suits, because I'll be honest with you, I hate this thing. Amen. Are y'all with me, men?
Yeah.
Listen, I don't know who invented this thing, but they ought to be strung up by it. It's miserable. But you know, you wear the preacher uniform, so you have to do that, because some people expect that, right? Anyway, it's a precious faith. I remember then, as I started to study the scripture, and I read through this, and it was like precious faith, and I remember many, many years ago as a young Christian, this just kind of jumped out at me. It's precious. We think of precious things as things that are precious to us, of value to us, don't we? I mean, I've got things that are precious to me, and I'm sure you have things that are precious to you, right? Most of mine are guns and motorcycles. People fall third on the list, I'm afraid. Amen. Come on. Amen. Hey, we got to be honest, right? But they're precious to me. Why are they precious to me? They're precious to me because they have sentimental value to me. Why are they precious to me? They're precious to me and not to you because they're mine. There is something that is precious to me It's precious to me because I have an investment of my life in it. Would you agree with that? Maybe you've got a precious car. Maybe you think your car is precious. If it ain't a Toyota four-wheel drive, it's not precious. I'll tell you that right now. But maybe your car is precious and you baby that thing and you wash it and you clean it. To somebody else and they look at your car and it's just a car. But we know about Sean and his car. But maybe to somebody else, it's just a hunk of metal. You just drive from place to place, but to you it means something. Why does it mean something? Because you have an attachment to it. And maybe, ladies, some of you ladies, y'all collect dust collector stuff. Statues and frying pans and salt and pepper shakers. How many salt and pepper shakers do we need in this world anyway, right? I know what my wife's thinking. As many guns as you got. But those things are precious to you. Why? Because they mean something to you. You've invested part of your life in it. You enjoy looking at it. You enjoy spending time around it. It makes you comfortable. Am I right or am I wrong? Now you and I need to understand we have faith today. And the faith that we have is a precious faith. It ought to mean something to us. It ought to be something very personal to us. I want you to know I was 25 when I got saved. I know where I was when I got saved. I was sitting in my car in Walmart parking lot in Harrisonburg. That's when I got saved. My salvation is precious to me because I knew that if I died without Jesus, I was going to hell. Now remember that night crying out to the Lord, "Oh God, I just don't want to die and go to hell. Oh God, I don't want to die and go to hell. Please save me." And I know where I was. And my God stepped in and my God saved my wretched soul. Not because of the prayer I prayed, but because I put my trust in the fact that He did it all for me. He hung upon that cross. He was whipped and beaten and bludgeoned and abused and spit upon and mocked, and the crown of thorns was driven on His brow, and He was beaten to a bloody pulp. That cross was lifted up and dropped in that hole, and all of His bones came out of joint. And folks, from 12 o'clock till 3 o'clock in the afternoon, it turned pitch black dark, and all of my wicked, wretched sin was put on Jesus. Jesus didn't just pay for it, He became it. He became my sin and your sin that we might be the righteousness of God. And my friend, I know where I was that day. I realized I was going to go to hell. And I know the day my God saved me. And I know right now I'm saved. Now for some of you, it's not a bam, there's a day like that. For some of you, it may have been over a period of weeks or months, and you started to realize that you needed Jesus in your life. I understand that. But there was a time in your life when you came to Christ. And folks, it took every drop of the blood of Jesus to save me. And it took every drop of the blood of Jesus to save you. It's costly. It's precious. And it's mine. It's mine. Of all the precious things that I have in this world, there is nothing more precious than my salvation. How about you? Are y'all with me this morning? Hey, it's Easter. Are you alive, church? There's nothing more precious to me than my salvation. Look, I love my motorcycle, and I love my guns, and I love all my stuff. I'm a carnal sap. I'm wicked. I'm telling you. And I love my stuff. But I'm going to die and leave it all behind. Yep. And then either Jill or Wes will sell it all, I know. Jill sells it, she's going to have frying pans. If Wes sells it, it'll be more guns, okay? But I'll be dead and gone, and that stuff means nothing. But my salvation will still be precious. Because I am going to heaven. Not because of anything I did, but because of what Jesus did. I'm on my way to heaven. I'm going to sit around the table one day and the Lord Himself, He's going to gird Himself and He's going to serve me. It's the marriage supper of the Lamb. Oh, praise God. And I'm going to come back to this earth in the millennial reign and I'm going to reign with Him. for 1,000 years plus a season. I'm going to reign with them. And then one day there's going to be a great white throne judgment. And I'm going to be right there with Jesus. And all the wicked are called up. And there may be some of you sitting in this church right now today. You don't know whether you're saved. You don't really care about salvation. You don't want to be saved. It's just Easter. You're trying to get somebody off your back, so you showed up at church. And you're going to be at the great white throne. And you're going to be cast into the lake of fire. I'm going to be there. But then, this earth melts with a great fervent heat, and my God's going to wipe away all tears from my eyes. And I'm never going to remember you ever again. I said, I'm never going to remember you, but you're going to remember me. Oh, preacher, this isn't for me. Oh, preacher, I don't even believe in that stuff. One split second in the fires of hell, you will give anything and everything to be able to come back to this day, Easter 2017, and fall upon your face broken and ask and beg God to save your wretched soul. Oh, friend, it's real. Oh, friend, it's real. It's real. We have a like precious faith. Listen to me very carefully. Our faith is of great cost and great value. What is our faith? Our faith is in nothing else but Jesus. Listen to me very, very carefully. Our faith has been cheapened in these last few years. It's been cheapened because of the growth of church. Folks, not every church loves Jesus. And not every church has the precious faith of Jesus. Folks, it cost Jesus everything to die and save us. And it is wrong for the church today to make a mockery of the holiness and purity and the righteousness of Jesus. Our God is a just God. Yes, our God is a loving God, but our God is also a God of wrath. And you either come to God His way, or you don't come at all. You don't come to God in open rebellion and sin and say, well, I'm going to keep my sin, but I'm going to be saved too. It doesn't work that way. That's not repentance. And except you repent, you shall all likewise perish. Are y'all still with me? Our faith is precious on this Easter Sunday. Yes, Jesus got up, and yes, Jesus will save any sinner that comes to Him with a contrite, a broken, a repentant heart. But you don't come to Jesus and ask Jesus to save you, intending to stay in full-on rebellion against the holiness of God and against the Word of God. If your life does not measure up to the Word of God, you don't have salvation, friend. Now, all of us sin because we have a sin nature. But we do not abide in, nor do we continue in, sin. We do not live a habitual lifestyle of sin. Do we sin? Yes. Do we live a habitual lifestyle of sin? Yes. Absolutely not. You cannot. God will not allow that. Look up here. What we are seeing in this generation today is everybody's on their way to heaven. Just go to your average funeral. Everybody's on their way to heaven. Not everybody's on their way to heaven. Not everybody in this room is on your way to heaven. No, no. Everybody goes to heaven. Everybody in America is a Christian. Or you're a Christian because you do good. You're a Christian because you believe in Jesus. You're a Christian because you love Jesus. It does not matter how much you do or know or love Jesus. It's whether He knows you. And the way God knows us is from the inside to the outside. Listen very carefully. I love you. I really do. And I want to tell you the truth. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Today, friend, on this Easter, all the Christian people today can rejoice and shout about their precious faith and the fact that we're going to heaven. Our faith is precious, but there are those within the confines of these four walls who are not yet repentant. Religious, maybe. Moral people, maybe. Good people, most certainly. But salvation has nothing to do with that. And please listen before I go any further. If you will not repent, I want you to understand this. If you will not turn from your sin, if you have no desire to turn from your sin, if you have no hunger to turn from your sin, and what is sin? Sin is missing the mark of God. All of us are sinners. Either we sin physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually, or all the above. And as a matter of fact, we do all the above. It's because of our sin that Jesus came. But you will not make light of Jesus' sacrifice and go to heaven. He paid it all. It's precious. It's costly. Are y'all following me this morning? I'm about to close. You know what that means? You've got to have more and more. He said, we have obtained like precious faith. You want to know one of the greatest things about having the same faith as Peter? One day I'm going to get to go to heaven and talk to Peter. He stuck his foot in his mouth a lot. If you read the Bible, you know it. But how many of us do the same dumb things? He wasn't all that in a bag of chips, and neither are we. But he's in heaven, and I'm going to see him. Matter of fact, I'm going to see Paul, and I'm going to see all of these great saints that are mentioned in the Bible, all the great saints throughout all the years. But the greatest one we get to see is Jesus. But my friend, if Jesus is not your Savior on this earth, He will be your judge. He will be your judge. Look at verse 3. According as His divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of Him that hath called us to glory and virtue. Listen very carefully. I've been doing this a long time. It seems like forever. And since I started preaching, even in the short 25 to 30 years that I've been doing this, folks, listen, I've seen 25 years, I've seen a difference. I've seen a change. I've seen a change in churches, and I've seen a change in people. I've seen a change in what's accepted in church. Just because it's legal in our country does not mean it's right in the sight of God. Paul said, all things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient. They're not the best choice to make. Now, folks, every one of us is born with a bent. Some of us are born with a bent for stealing and lying and cheating. Some are born with a bent for sexual immorality and deviant behavior. We all have a bent. My friend, we have got to face that bent and realize that sin, and that's what separates us from God. And we've got to come to God and allow God to change that in us. And we've got to want to have God to change that. And if there's no want to have God to change that, there is no eternal life, because He gives us life. And He gives us all things that pertain unto life. God tells us all things that pertain unto life. Listen to me on this Easter Sunday, listen. God gives us everything we need to live a holy and a just and a godly life. It all starts with repentance and salvation. God tells us how to live holy and how to be godly and how to be right. In our modern church, we go, I don't need that old book. I don't need that old-fashioned way. I don't need that old stuff. I don't want that old stuff. I want my own way. I want to do my own thing. I'm just as good as you are. Yeah, no joke. It don't take much. But the difference is I'm saved. You know why I'm saved? Because I know I'm a filthy, wretched sinner in the sight of God. And there's no hope for me outside of Jesus. And I deal with people all the time and say, well, Pastor Paul, that's just what you believe. I believe something else. Whoop-de-doo. We can't both be right. This book is right where I'm wrong. And this book is right where you're wrong. And you're going to give an account to God in the last day, not by what Pastor Paul says, but by what this book says. Everybody all right?
Yeah.
Our life should be precious. I jotted these things down. Look over in the Gospel of John, and I'm done this morning. The Gospel of John. The Gospel of John, chapter number 17. This is right before Jesus goes to the cross. John chapter number 17 is actually the Lord's Prayer. We call the Lord's Prayer, you know, that other thing. That other thing is in Scripture, but that's a model prayer. That's not the Lord's Prayer. John chapter 17 is the Lord's Prayer. He is praying for us. For those believers down throughout all of time. And he says some very important things. Look at this if you will. John 17 verse 1. These words spake Jesus, and he lifted up his eyes to heaven, and he said, Father, the hour is come. What hour? The hour where he's going to the cross of Calvary. The hour where he is going to drink that cup of bitterness for you and me. That hour where he becomes our sin so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. It's the hour whereby he pays it all, and it cost him everything. And my friends, it cost him everything. It cost us nothing, but we must come his way. The hour's come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son may glorify thee. You are not ever going to glorify God by any life you live outside of having the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Master. To be saved does not mean that you just have fire insurance from hell. To be saved means that God Almighty, the Lord Jesus Christ, is the Lord, the Master of your life. And when you live a life that's contrary to the Word, there will be chastening and chastisement. The Holy Spirit of God will chasten you. Every son I love, I chasten. And if there is no chastisement, if you can go out and get drunk, and live sexually immoral, and you can do drugs, and run around, and lie, and cheat, and steal, and the Holy Spirit of God does not bring conviction upon your life, then you are a bastard and not God's son. End of story. You're not saved. You can shack up, have sex outside of marriage, live an ungodly, wicked lifestyle, and you do not feel as the biggest scumball that ever lived, like you just put Jesus back on the cross. You, sir, you, ma'am, are still yet in your sins, and you are going to hell. But I've got good news. If you would repent, look in the mirror of the Word of God, and see how dirty, how wretched, and how filthy you are, then God will save you. You are looking at a man who's a liar, a cheat, a thief, a murderer, a sexual demon, immoral. That's me in my nature, and that's me in my bent, and that's exactly the way I behaved and the way I acted when I was lost. And I can tell you this, my God knows this, that when I'm trying to live for Jesus, that's the same way the devil tries to get me tripped up right now. And every one of you that's saved knows exactly what I'm talking about. But there's a difference. I can no longer live in that because I have got the Holy Spirit of God on the inside. All things pass away. All things become new. I am a new creature in Jesus Christ. I'm saved. I know I'm saved because I cannot live that way. And I cannot tolerate that. Christians are narrow-minded. Christians are narrow-minded. There is no room for anything ungodly or wicked. And those who say they're saved and are yet lost will call you a bigot. We'll call you all kinds of names. You and I need to understand God calls us another name. Righteous, holy, just, pure, undefiled, and ready for heaven. Don't worry what that wicked world thinks. And there may be some of you sitting in this church this morning, and you say, oh, preacher, I go to church, I'm just as good as anybody else. Are you now? Are you now? Because my righteousness is not on the outside, it's on the inside. Are you just as good? No. Look up here at me before I lose all y'all. No. I am, because of God, a child of God, a saint of God, a joint heir with Jesus, a prince. I'm an ambassador of another world. If you don't have Jesus, friend, you are of your father, the devil, who is the father of all lies. And the greatest lie told to this generation is, you can have eternal life outside of Jesus. You can have eternal life by being good. You can have eternal life by being religious. You've got to be righteous. And that's a whole different ballgame. Everybody still with me, even though you're mad at me? As thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life. Eternal life. Eternal life. Eternal life. Without any beginning and without any ending. I have got eternal life. God said I do. God said he gave it to us. Those who are washed in the blood of the Lamb. Those who are saved. Those who have repented and put their trust in nothing else but Jesus. We have right this very minute eternal, never ending, never taken away, never going away, life. Eternal. For those of you that think you can lose it, then you don't have eternal life. You've got temporary life. I've got eternal life. It's a whole lot better. Everybody still with me? I'll be sweet and kind in a minute. Hang on. And this is the life eternal. This is the life eternal. That they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom thou sent. I glorified thee on the earth. I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. Look at verse 13. And now come out of thee, that these things I speak in the world, that they might have my joy fulfilled in themselves. All right, I'll get nice. Here's your Joel Osteen for the moment. Look up here. My teeth are crookeder, and they got coffee stains. I don't have the millions to get a fake smile, okay? Listen to me. God wants us. How many of y'all are saved in this place this morning? You know you're saved. You don't doubt it. You know you are. But let me tell you something. Our God wants to give you a joy-filled life. A life that's filled with joy. Joy has nothing to do with happiness. Joy has everything to do with Jesus. Folks, I want you to know something. We talked about heaven. We talked about the fact we're going to heaven. We talked about all that stuff. But I want to tell you the greatest thing is this. One day we're going to be with Jesus. We're never going to fail Him. We're never going to fail each other. We're never going to have a bad day ever again. How many of y'all have bad days? How many of y'all have a bad life? Some of y'all, it just seems like you ride under the fertilizer truck. You know what I'm talking about? You got both hands on the release switch. Just dump on me. Dump on me. I me tell you something. Our God's a great God and a mighty God and a good God. Yes, our God is a God of judgment and wrath, but He's going to drop His judgment and His wrath on all those that won't accept Him. So all y'all that are lost in this place today, you got a chance to repent. I got good news. God came, He loved you, He died for you. But if you don't repent, you want to die and go to hell, go. You ain't affecting me one little bit. Go ahead. For those of us that are saved, listen to me. Our life is more than this earth. This is not your best life. And there went your Jehovah's Witness moment. This is not your best life now. Our best is yet to come.
Amen.
Folks, we're going to have a body like Christ and a mind like Christ and a heart like Christ. We're going to think like Him and move like Him and work like Him and do like Him and be like Him.
Amen.
I love Jesus this morning. More and more and more. Because the older I get, the less I like me. I mean, I know my faults, and I know my failures. I want everyone in this room to know something. If God can save me, if God can bring conviction upon me and show me an arrogant, prideful, self-righteous bigot that I need to break and accept Jesus, God can save you. If God can take somebody who's lived the life that I've lived, and folks, if my life, listen, every one of y'all probably better than me. All of y'all. If my life was put on that screen right there today, I want you, look up here, I'm being real serious with y'all. If my life was played on that screen, would none of y'all want me to be up here talking? Awful. Horrendous. Wicked. My God saved me. My joy has nothing to do with the health of my body. My joy has nothing to do with my stuff. My joy has nothing to do with outside relationships. My joy comes from the Lord. My joy comes from a future that I have with my Lord. My joy comes from knowing no matter what happens, I'm going to be with my Lord. That's where real joy comes from. Do you have the joy of the Lord this morning? Are you saved this morning? Do you know Christ? Do you have that precious faith? Are you living a precious life? Do you have that precious eternal life? Do you have it? Those of you that couldn't say yes, and for those of you that say no, I want you to know I've done all that I can do. I can actually do no more. I can do no more. There may be one of you out there right now. We're going to have an invitation in just a minute. When we have the invitation, I don't have you repeat a prayer and such, because I don't want you trusting in the prayer. I want you to get real, real with God. Okay? Now I want you to ask yourself this one question. If I stand before God today, God asks me, why should I let you into heaven? What would you tell God? What would you tell Him? If you'd say, well now Lord, look, I went to church. He's going to say, depart from me. I didn't know. You say, but Lord, remember that day? I mean, I was baptized in front of everybody. That's not why you go to heaven, friend. Lord, there's only one answer. And you've got to find out if this is your answer. Because I cannot get there on my own. Why should I let you into heaven, Lord? The Lord asked you. Because God, I realized I couldn't get there on my own. I couldn't get there on my own. I need you. Remember that day? Remember that time, Lord? When and I just put my trust in you. That's the only answer. For with the heart, man believes unto righteousness. And with the mouth, confession is made unto or about salvation. I'm saved because of what Jesus did. You're saved because of what Jesus did when you put your trust in Him. Is everybody with me this morning?
Amen.
Let's all stand. Let's all stand.